एवरीवन, आई एम संघर्ष घिमिरे, फोर्थ ईयर स्टूडेंट फ्रॉम द बीपीकेएचएस। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट द पैथोलॉजी एंड पैथोजेनेसिस ऑफ एसएलई, डीएलई एंड डर्मेटोमायोसाइटिस। बिफोर स्टार्टिंग दिस स्लाइड, आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर सुधा अग्रवाल मैम फॉर हेल्पिंग मी व्हाइल मेकिंग दिस स्लाइड। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, बिफोर स्टार्टिंग द टॉपिक प्रॉपर, आई वुड लाइक टू tell you something that the term collagen vascular disease is misnomer, as there is no any evidence of primary involvement of collagen in when writing the one of the cause of the pyrexia of unknown origin or the cause of the joint pain. We used to write the term collagen vascular disease, but nowadays this term is considered misnomer, and now the term connective tissue disease is used. Today there will be discussion of the some of the cutaneous autoimmune connective tissue disease. We would discuss lupus erythematosus, dermatomyositis, and the disease scleroderma will be discussed in the further slide. First of all, the lupus erythematosus had the three variant: mild, moderate, and the aggressive variant. The chronic cutaneous lupus erythematosus, it is the somewhat mild form of the disease. Some of the writers like to use the term discoid lupus erythematosus instead of chronic cutaneous lupus erythematosus. Then another is the moderate, somewhat moderate form of the disease, subacute cutaneous lupus erythematosus. Then the aggressive multisystem disease, acute cutaneous lupus erythematosus, which is associated with the systemic lupus erythematosus. After discussing that, we will discuss the dermatomyositis also in this slide. And also, the discoid lupus erythematosus has the two form. One is the localized form and the disseminated form. The localized form is involved in the head, scalp, and the face region, while the disseminated form will be also, the lesion will be appear in the trunk region, in the leg region, or the and the also the head, scalp, and the face region. There is some controversy that whether the DLE and the SLE are the variant of the same disease. There are some points in favor and there are the some points that require explanation. First of all, the what are the points that are in favor? First point is that the sum of the lesion that appear in the DLE and the SLE are thus show some type of the similarity, and also the many symptoms that are present in the SLE are also present in the DLE patients, which also favor that the DLE and SLE may be the variant of the same disease. Also, it is found that the some of the patient of the DLE later converted into the SLE. So this point also favor the that the DLE and the SLE are the variant of the same diseases. And also the some of the biochemical, hematological, and the other lab parameter also favor that the DLE and SLE are the variant of the same disease. And also the lupus paniculitis, this is the one clinical form that is present both in the DLE and the SLE. And also the chronic form of the SLE shows that the lesion of the chronic form of the SLE is also similar to that of the DLE. So these are the points that are in favor, but there are some points that require explanation. For example, not all patients of the DLE will be converted into the SLE. Only some percentage of the patient will be converted into the SLE. Only 1.3 to 6.5% of the patient will be converted into the SLE. The type of the variant of the DLE, the disseminated DLE, will be converted to the SLE in approximately 23% of the patient as compared to the localized form of the DLE. And also, so this small percentage requires some explanation here. And also, some of the biochemical parameters that are present in the DLE may not directly show the pathogenesis of the conversion from the DLE to the SLE. And also, The immunoglobulin and the complement are present in the uninvolved skin of the patient with SLE and absent in the patient with the DLE. And the also the most patient of the DLE that experience the some type of stress, trauma and the exposure to UV radiation never gets converted into the SLE. The most the two type of the HLA gene, HLA-B7 and the HLA-B8 are the two genes that are mostly associated with the discoid lupus erythematosus that are studied in the some of the research, which show that HLA-B7 are the present in the patient of the discoid lupus erythematosus that develop the diseases on the onset of the 15 to 39 years of age, while the HLA-B8 is present in the patient of the DLE that develop the disease after the onset of the 40 years of age. So and also it is the found that the SLE patient has also the HLA-B7 gene present, and also the patient with disseminated DLE patient which later converted into the SLE have also the HLA-B7 gene. So that we can make a conclusion that the patient who convert from DLE to SLE and those with SLE we have discussed discoid skin lesion must be genetically predisposed to the both condition. So we can say that patient may have predisposed to either SLE, DLE or the both, and the patient with genotype solely for DLE will never convert it to SLE. The presence of HLA-B8 in a young female with DLE may represent a risk factor for the development of the systemic disease. But but today's time, we cannot identify the genetic pattern in the all of the patients. So identifying a patient who will later convert it into the SLE, this is really impossible and very hard in this time. So this is some of the research that was conducted. So this research show that the DLE and SLE may be the different type of the disease. So first topic, discoid lupus erythematosus. The disease is the chronic form that I have already said that. Here is the manifestation like skin plague, erythema, scaliness, follicular plugging and elevated erythematous border are the present and may mimic SLEs. But systemic manifestation are rare here. Antibody against the double stranded DNA is rarely present in this disease. This is the lesion. The epidemiology. The incidence is 4 to 7 out of 1 lakh patients. The peak incidence is 4th decades in female and slightly later in males. The sex ratio is female to male 2:1 ratio. The disease is more common in Asian African American population. The disease is associated with porphyria, pemphigus, myasthenia gravis and thymoma. The genetic factor that is associated with the DLE are the HLA-B7 and HLA-B8, which I have already discussed, and also CW7, and the relative risk increase with certain combination of antigens such as HLA-CW7, DR3 and many more. Family history is 4%. Here are the some of the predisposing factor to the discoid lupus erythematosus with the percentage shown here. They are trauma including x-ray, diathermy, ultraviolet exposure, some of the infection like herpes zoster or the old smallpox vaccination, and some of the drug like isoniazid, penicillamine, and some seasonal exacerbation is present. Pathophysiology. The inflammatory pattern that involved in the pathogenesis of the discoid lupus erythematosus mirrors that of the innate immune response to the cutaneous viral infection. The interference response is the innate immune response against the antiviral, against the virus. So here interferon type I and type 3 are produced in the patient with the discoid lupus erythematosus, which will trigger the TH1 biased inflammation. So after this, this will be followed by the some of the epidermal damage, basement membrane thickening and scarring tissue response associated with the loss of follicular stem cells. And also there is interferon alpha and interferon gamma production is there. The interferon alpha is produced by the plasmacytoid dendritic cell and the interferon gamma is produced by the keratinocyte. That induces the keratinocyte expression of the pro-inflammatory chemokines as well as the TNF related apoptosis inducing ligand TRAIL molecule and its receptors. In discoid lupus erythematosus, the sun may act as the trigger, and also there is some evidence that the response of the toll like receptor, heat shock protein and danger associated molecular pattern are also shown. This is some clinical feature which will be discussed by by another presenter, but here it's shown here. The histological feature of the cutaneous lupus erythematosus is present here. Here we can see that some of the keratotic plugging and also the liquefactive degeneration of the basal layer, edema and alienization of the connective tissue below the epidermis, and also there are some of the dermal mucinosis, epidermal atrophy. This is the same animation with the simplified version. The histology will be like, there is the sum of the follicular plugging, there will be the perifollicular infiltration, perivascular infiltration, and the basal cell degeneration, liquefactive degeneration in epidermis, thickening in the pallor of the epidermis. There will be the carpet taxane, which will be discussed by the another presenter, Shashank Bhattarai, in more detail. This is the carpet taxane. Liquefactive degeneration of the basal cell layer. In the dermis, there will be the degenerative change in the connective tissue also. Patchy dermal lymphocyte infiltration with few plasma cell and histiocytes. Premature elastotic degeneration of the collagen in light exposed area. Dermal deposition of the mucin and pilosebaceous atrophy. This is the same figure. Immunopathology shows that the presence of IgG, IgA and IgM and complement at the dermo-epidermal junction. After discussing that, our second topic is the systemic lupus erythematosus. The lupus means fox. I don't know why this term is related to the fox, but this is the autoimmune disease that involves the multi-organ characterized by vast area of autoantibodies, particularly anti-nuclear antibodies. The injury is caused mainly by the deposition of the immune complexes and the binding of antibodies to the various cells and tissues. The fundamental defect in a failure of mechanism that maintain the self-tolerance. The self-tolerance means the unresponsiveness of our the immune system against our natural antigen of our the body, of our own antigen. So the while discussing the etiology and pathogenesis of the SLE, there are involvement of the genetic factor, immunologic factor, and also the environmental factor. Not one factor can solely explain the pathogenesis of the SLE. First of all, we are going to talk the family history. It is shown that the family member of the SLE patient has the higher chance of developing the disease, and the first degree relative has the comparatively more chance of developing the disease, up to the 20%. Also, the monozygotic twin, higher rate of concordance in the monozygotic twin as compared to the dizygotic twin has been shown. There is association of the two HLA gene, HLA DR2 and the DR3, associated with the production of the antibodies. There is the inherited deficiency of the early complement component like C2, C4 or the CA1Q. These complement are involved in the removal of the immune complexes by the mononuclear phagocyte. So their deficiency means that the chance of immune complex deposition will be more, and also the deficiency of the C3b might also be present. The more the deposition of the immune complexes in the glomerular region or in the blood vessel will cause the disease presentation. And let's discuss some of the immunologic factor. There I have already discussed the failure of the self-tolerance in B cells. This is the main culprit behind this disease, causes the defective elimination of the self-reactive B cells. While development of the B cells in the bone marrow, the B cells that are reactive against our self antigens are either undergone apoptosis or the some of the receptor editing, and when there is the failure in this system, we call this as the failure of self tolerance in the B cells. These B cells will ultimately develop the antibodies against our own nuclear antigen. So this is one of the main culprit. And also, it has been shown that there is the CD4 helper T cell specific for the nucleosomal antigen might also have escaped from our bone marrow and the thymus. Here it is shown that the T cell dependent antibodies production in the germinal center and the proliferation of the follicular helper T cells is shown, so that the T cells that might not have gone apoptosis later may trigger the B cells to produce the antibody. And also the toll-like receptor. The toll-like receptor are the receptor that are the part of the innate immune system. These receptors are activated against a certain microbes associated molecular pattern or the pathogen associated molecular pattern. So the B cell that are specific for the nuclear antigen will be get another second signal if that these toll-like receptor are activated. In this patient, this toll-like receptor might be activated after their exposure to the our own nuclear antigen. झुकिए जस्तो भयो के त्यसपछि अर्को देयर इज अल्सो सम इन द पेसेन्ट देयर इज सोन द्याट द लेभल अफ द टाइप वान इन्टरफेरन इन इज हाई इन द ब्लड. सो इट इज अल्सो पोस्टुलेटेड द्याट द टाइप वान इन्टरफेरन रेस्पोन्स मे बी अल्सो प्रेजेन्ट इन द एसएलई पेसेन्ट, बट how this type 1 interferon will cause the disease is still unknown. We know that these interferon are the antiviral proteins. So when the type 1 interferons are increased, it is believed that they might activate the B cells, also the dendritic cells and the T cells, and further exacerbate the disease. These type 1 interferons are produced after that the toll like receptor detect the sum of the antigen, and this type 1 interferon will be produced by the dendritic cells. The environmental factor. And also it is shown that the exposure to the UV light might develop also the SLE disease. Here the UV light will cause the induction of the apoptosis of the cell and also the DNA alteration of the cell. Once the DNA is altered, it might becomes immunogenic. Body might not detect the altered DNA is the own DNA, and it may suppose that the DNA is foreign body. So our body might develop immune system against that, immunity against that. And also it is the patient who is already have developed the SLE disease. The UV light will modulate the immune response by the increased amount of the interleukin 1 by the keratinocyte. The interleukin 1 will increase the inflammatory response in our body. And also the gender, sex hormone has some role in the development of disease, as it has been shown that the disease presentation is somewhat 9:1 ratio in the female to male ratio in the patient of the reproductive age, while it is only 2:1 in the patient younger patient and the patient greater than 65 years of age. So sex hormone might also have some role. And also nowadays it is believed that some of the gene on the X chromosome, like interleukin receptor associated kinase 1 gene, IRAK1 gene, has also might have some role in developing this disease. The some of the drugs like hydralazine, procainamide and the d-penicillamine might have also role in developing the disease. Some of the SLE like feature may be shown while taking this drug. The hydralazine has higher chance to develop these features if the patient has the HLA-DR4 association, and the procainamide might have chance if the patient has the DR six association. Now this is the some picture I would like to describe here. So the patient which have failure of the self tolerance in the T cells and the B cells, and the some of the external triggers like the UV radiation will cause the apoptosis of the cell, so that the defective clearance of the apoptotic bodies, if present in our bodies, there is the increased chance of exposure of the nuclear antigen. Of course, these cells will consider this antigen as the foreign body, and these will produce some of the antibody against them. These antibody are called anti-nuclear antibody. Then antigen antibody complexes will form. There is some antigen, also there is antigen antibody complex. After that, and also dendritic cell have the toll-like TLR, toll-like receptor. If there is some mistake in this receptor, they will also develop type 1 interferon response, and also dendritic cell will directly activate the B cells to further production of the antibodies. Just ki agoma ghyu thapne kaam garchan ke yiniharule, and testai once the persistent high level of the so that the higher amount of the antibodies will be produced, once the persistent high level of the anti-nuclear IgG antibody production will be there, then there will be the damage, more damage of the cell, and the more damage of the cell, the more release of the own nuclear antigen, and the more is the release of the own nuclear antigen, the more will be the immune response. This vicious cycle will go on, and the condition of the patient may deteriorate with the time. Condition of the patient might get deteriorate with the time. There are some of the autoantibodies that are presented in the SLE patient. For example, the antibody will be produced against double stranded DNA, and then also the antibodies are also present against the U1 ribonucleoprotein. Then there are some of the other antibody against the Smith antigen, and also there might be RoSSA and LASSB antibody, and also there will be the production of antiphospholipid antibody. After we have learned how the SLE disease has developed, now we are going to talk how SLE will cause the tissue injury. One of the we know that there are various kind of presentation. There the SLE present SLE affect the various kind of the various organ of our body. The first response type 3 hypersensitivity is responsible for the injury to the kidney and the small blood vessel. What happen here is there is the deposition of the antigen antibody complexes in the kidney, in the glomeruli, in the basement membrane, sub endothelial and sub epithelial space. So these will cause further deterioration. How I will discuss somewhat later. And also there is also autoantibodies directed against the RBC, WBC and platelet, in addition to the anti-nuclear antibody. This will cause the autoimmune hemolytic anemia, autoimmune thrombocytopenic purpura, and the there is also leukopenia in the patient. So the patient may develop anemia, leukopenia and thrombocytopenia. And also secondary antiphospholipid syndrome is present in the SLE patient. The term secondary is here because the antiphospholipid syndrome is present secondary to the SLE. Here the patient might develop the lupus anticoagulant antibody. Here the term anticoagulant is used, but instead of this, paradoxically the patient develop the hypercoagulable state. So deep vein thrombosis, thrombosis in the cerebral blood vessel, and also recurrent miscarriage may be present in with patient developing secondary antiphospholipid syndrome. So, and also there are some of the neuropsychiatric manifestation. The neuropsychiatric manifestation may be presented at the some of the psychotic features, seizures, and the non-inflammatory. This is believed that the neuropsychiatric manifestation might be as a result of the vasculitis, but nowadays it is believed that the non-inflammatory occlusion by intimal proliferation of the endothelial cells might be the cause behind those symptoms. After that, what are the organ system does SLE attack? The virtually all organ system are affected by the SLE. Those are the skins, kidneys, cardiovascular system, joints, bones, central nervous system, serosal cavity, spleen, lung, blood vessels. I will like to discuss the underlying part in the discuss in the detail. So first of all, joint. The patient might develop the feature of the some of the joint pain, arthralgia, as of the rheumatoid arthritis, and also in the bones, avascular necrosis may be present in the patient with the SLE. Central nervous system, the patient may present as the seizure or some of the neuropsychiatric manifestation, psychosis. Body serosal cavity. The patient may develop the pericarditis, and also serosal cavity involvement is present as this. The first of all, the some of the exudate will be presented in the serosa. Then there will be some thickening of the serosal layer. Then in the later stage of the disease, the complete obliteration of the serosal cavity may be present. And also there in the spleen, there will be splenomegaly, capsular enlargement, and in the lung, the patient may present at the some of the pleural effusion, pleurisy, and some of the interstitial disease. In the blood vessel, the patient may present at the some of the vasculitis of the blood vessel. Now discuss the skin, kidneys, and cardiovascular system in the detail. This is the classical presentation of the SLE. These are the molar rays. The further clinical feature of the skin will be discussed by my friend Shashank Bhattarai in this another slide. Here we can see that in the epidermis, the patient has the hyperkeratosis. These are the some histological finding. There will be the keratotic plugging of the hair follicle and the glandular orifice. There will be the atrophy of the precursor cell. And also there will be the degeneration of the basal layer, which will be the liquefactive degeneration. And also there will be the extravasation of the erythrocyte. We can see there is the fibrinoid degeneration of the blood vessel. There will be the perivascular lymphohistiocytic infiltration. And in the dermis, there will be some of the edematous dermal tissue. There will be the infiltration of the lymphocyte, abundant T cells, and some of the B cells. And also there will be the hyaline change, fibrinoid degeneration of the blood vessels in the dermis. The immune histology showed that the immunoglobulin predominantly the IgG and less frequently the IgM and IgA with complement C1, C3 at the dermoepidermal junction. Deposits are more frequently present in the light exposed area of the electron microscopy. And also the staining may be homogeneous or granular, even a larger aggregate according to the type of antibody, which will be discussed by my friend Satya Mandal in the details. This is the immunoglobulin deposition at the dermoepidermal junction. The kidney is one of the organ that is most frequently involved in the SLE patient. There in the 50% of the SLE patient, there is the involvement of the kidney, and the presentation will be like classified at the from the type 1 to type 6, but this is not somewhat exclusive form of the presentation. The patient with one form of disease might later get converted to the another form of disease, so we are going to just talk this as the separate entity, but these are not exclusive. First of all, minimal mesangial lupus nephritis. What happened in the minimal mesangial lupus nephritis is this. There will be the deposition of the immune complexes in the mesangium first. In the class 2 means somewhat severe form of the disease. So there will be mesangial hypercellularity, means there will be the proliferation of the mesangium after the immune complex deposition. Then class 3 and class 4. In the class 3, there will be the focal lupus nephritis, and in the class 4, there will be the diffuse lupus nephritis. The focal means there will be involvement of the less than 50% of the total of the glomeruli of the whole kidney, एंड देयर विल बी द ग्रेटर देन 50% इन्वल्भमेन्ट अफ दि टोटल अफ दि ग्लोमेरुलाई अफ दि होल किडनी. इन दि डिफ्युज लुपस नेफ्राइटिस इट इज क्लासिफाइड इन्टु दि सेगमेन्टल अर दि ग्लोबल. सेगमेन्टल मिन्स द इन्भल्भ ग्लोमेरुलाई, वान ग्लोमेरुलाई देयर इफ देयर इज सेगमेन्टल प्याटर्न अफ दि इन्भल्भमेन्ट अर दि इफ होल अफ दि ग्लोमेरुलाई इज इन्भल्भ देन वी कल्ड इट द ग्लोमेरुलर डिफ्युज लुपस नेफ्राइटिस. हेयर इज द डिपोजिसन इज दि सब इन्डोथेलियल डिपोजिसन. बट इन दि मेम्ब्रानस लुपस नेफ्राइटिस देयर विल बी द सब एपिथेलियल डिपोजिसन. इन डिफ्युज लुपस नेफ्राइटिस द पेसेन्ट मे प्रेजेन्ट एट द सम अफ दि हेमाचुरिया लाइक फिचर एन्ड नेफ्रिटिक सिन्ड्रम लाइक फिचर. इन दि मेम्ब्रानस लुपस नेफ्राइटिस देयर विल बी द डिपोजिसन इन दि सब एपिथेलियल मेम्ब्रेन. सो द पेसेन्ट मे हेभ द फिचर अफ दि नेफ्रोटिक सिन्ड्रम, प्रोटिनुरिया एन्ड अदर फिचर्स. इन दि एडभान्स स्क्लेरोसिस लुपस नेफ्राइटिस हेयर द स्क्लेरोसिस अफ दि मोर देन 90% अफ दि ग्लोमेरुलाई विल बी प्रेजेन्ट एन्ड दि दिस इज द इन्ड स्टेज रिनल डिजिज क्लिनिकल्ली. द हार्ट इन्भल्भमेन्ट देयर विल बी आई हेभ अलरेडी कल्ड देयर विल बी पेरिकार्डाइटिस एन्ड अल्सो सम अफ दि इन्डोकार्डियल इन्भल्भमेन्ट विल बी देयर इन दि भल्भ. मेन भल्भ आर दि एओर्टिक भल्भ एन्ड दि माइट्रल भल्भ. वाट विल ह्यापन हियर इज देयर विल बी द डिफ्युज लिफलेट थिकनिङ अफ दि भल्भ एन्ड अल्सो देयर इज द लिबमेन स्याक इन्डोकार्डाइटिस विच मिन्स दिस इज द क्लासिक फर्म अफ दि इन्डोकार्डाइटिस द्याट इज प्रेजेन्ट इन दि पेसेन्ट विथ दि सिस्टमिक लुपस इराइडेमाटोसस. देयर दिस इज द कल्चर नेगेटिभ लिबमेन स्याक कल्चर नेगेटिभ इन्डोकार्डाइटिस स्टेराइल इन्डोकार्डाइटिस एन्ड अल्सो कोरोनरी आर्टरी इन्भल्भमेन्ट. नाउ अ डेज मोस्ट अफ दि पेसेन्ट्स रिसिभ सम अफ दि इम्युन सप्रेसन ड्रग्स, सम अफ दि स्टेरोइड, सो दे हेभ द प्रोलङ लाइफ स्प्यान. बट द मेन कज अफ दि डेथ इन दि पेसेन्ट विथ दि एसएलई इज नाउ अ डेज इज द कोरोनरी आर्टरी इन्भल्भमेन्ट. देयर विल बी सम अफ दि एथेरोस्क्लेरोसिस, देयर इज द हायर चान्स अफ दि एथेरोस्क्लेरोसिस इन दि अर्ली एज इन द पेसेन्ट विथ दि सिस्टमिक लुपस इराइडेमाटोसस. We can see that some of the valvular involvement here. This is the leaflet thickening we can see here. The leaflet thickening in the Lippmann's sac endocarditis will be smaller than that of the infective endocarditis. However, it is larger than that of the leaflet thickening will be larger than that of the rheumatoid heart disease. Now our second topic, second topic is the dermatomyositis. But instead of reading it separate entity, first of all we should have some idea about the inflammatory myopathies. So inflammatory myopathies is the spectrum of the disease where at one end there is polymyositis, where the multiple involvement of the muscle involvement will be there and with the minimal involvement of the skin, whereas at the other end there is the amyopathic dermatomyositis where the most predominant involvement of the skin with the less involvement of the muscle will be here. And also there are some dermatomyositis and the inclusion body myositis. In the dermatomyositis, there is involvement of the dermis, and the dermis means skins, and the also the muscles is explained by this word. Dermatomyositis, the patient present with the proximal muscle weakness. The patient cannot squat, the patient has difficulty standing up, and also there will be some skin changes in the certain cases. And also in the dermatomyositis patient there will be the lung involvement at the interstitial lung disease, some of the joint involvement, there is the involvement of the oropharynx and also the heart. This is the classical heliotrope erythematous rash present in the dermatomyositis, which will be discussed by another presenter. The varieties of dermatomyositis, there are some variety like juvenile variety, adult variety. The classic dermatomyositis with the associated with the malignancy, and the classic dermatomyositis is a part of overlying connective tissue disorder. Also, this is also called as the dermatomyositis with the overlying disorder, overlying syndrome, dermatomyositis with overlying syndrome. So the juvenile variety had the two form also, classic dermatomyositis and the amyopathic dermatomyositis. In the adult variety, classic dermatomyositis and of course classic dermatomyositis with malignancy, as malignancy is more common in the older age. This form will be present of course in the adult patient. And also the dermatomyositis with the overlap syndrome, here in addition to the dermatomyositis, the patient may develop systemic lupus erythematosus or the scleroderma. And also here is also amyopathic dermatomyositis. The etiology, the genetic factor, there are some HLA like HLA-B8, DR3, and the absence of second component of the complement C2 may also be involved in the development of the dermatomyositis. The peak incidence of the development of the dermatomyositis is 50 to 70 years of age, with the higher chance, higher incident in the adult age compared to the childhood. The female to male ratio in the adult is 2:1, while in childhood the ratio is somewhat larger, which is 5:1. There are some environmental factors like in heavy muscular exertion, some drugs, infection, and the ultraviolet ray may predispose to the dermatomyositis, but this is not clearly explained. The associated disease here, in the dermatomyositis associated with the malignancy, which is more common in the adult, I have already said that there is association with the internal malignancies such as adenocarcinoma of the breast, ovary, lung, and the nasopharyngeal carcinoma will be there. The what is the pathogenesis here? So here is, this is the type of disease where some of the immunologic response or the reaction that are present in the small blood vessel cause the muscle injury. And also vasculopathic changes are seen as the some of the telangiectasia in nail fold, eyelid, and the gum. So I have already discussed there will be the deposition of the some of membrane attack complex C5B29 in the capillaries, and the muscle injury will be there. It is present that the upregulation of the HLA-1 in the muscle cells, muscle fascicles, and also in the various kind of tissue in the body, various kind of tissue of the patient with the dermatomyositis. This is the histological slide showing the perifascicular area with the muscle fiber atrophy. We can see here, there is some of the atrophy here is compared to here. It is used to believe that the hypoxic stress might be the cause, as the blood vessel deposition of the membrane attack complex is here. But nowadays it is believed that there might be some of the type 1 interferon mediated pathway. This is the recent theory that is used to explain the perifascicular muscle atrophy. Here will be the infiltration of the B cells, CD4 T cells, in the perifascicular area. But in the polymyositis, what happen in the polymyositis is the infiltration of these cells in the muscle fascicles inside them. So here is, this is the main difference between the histology of the polymyositis and the dermatomyositis. Here I would also like to highlight the thing that humoral mediated microvasculopathy is present in the dermatomyositis, whereas in polymyositis there will be the cell mediated cytotoxicity associated with the CD8 plus T cells. Of course there will be the deposition of the membrane attack complex in biopsy sample of the capillary bed in the both tissues of the both tissue, skin and the muscle. And also there are some antibodies that are present in the patient with the dermatomyositis. These are classified as the myositis specific antibodies like anti-MI2, MDA5 and the sumo activating enzyme, and also myositis associated antibodies like anti-52 kilodalton RO protein, UN ribonuclear protein, and also anti-polymyositic scleroderma protein. This protein, this antibodies is present in patient with dermatomyositis, which also have the scleroderma. So these are the associated antibodies in the patient who had the myositis overlap syndrome. And also the UN ribonuclear protein, this is not specific to the specific form of the myositis overlap syndrome. The I would like to focus two antibody, MDA5 and the anti-JO1 antibodies, which are the myositis specific antibodies that correlates with the some of the that correlates with the dermatomyositis. And I would also like to discuss anti-JO1 antibodies. This antibody is one of the type of anti-synthetase antibodies. This is present in the patient with the anti-synthetase syndrome. In patient with anti-synthetase syndrome, there will be the N-terminal proteolytic fragment of the sterile tRNA synthetase. This antibody will target the N-terminal proteolytic fragment where the amino component will be the histidine group. So the sterile tRNA synthetase is the antibody that will present, which is also called as the anti-JO1 antibodies. That antibodies will cause the chemotaxis to the lymphocyte and the activated monocyte, which will cause the damage of the muscles. In 20 to 30% in pure polymyositis patient, there is presence of these antibodies. And in the 5 to 10% of the dermatomyositis patient, there will be presence of the anti-JO1 antibodies. Not all patient. This will present at the present in patient with the anti-synthetase syndrome, which also have the dermatomyositis. So these are the antibodies. The anti-JO1 antibodies, also called sterile tRNA synthetase antibody. These antibodies are not organ specific, but these are ubiquitous in the all of the human cells like lung. These antigens are also present in the lung, so these patients have the higher chance of developing the interstitial lung disease. So the patient with the anti-synthetase syndrome or the dermatomyositis patient who has anti-JO1 antibodies has the higher tendency of developing interstitial lung disease as compared to the other patient. And also anti-PL7, anti-PL2L are the other antibodies, anti-synthetase antibodies, that might be present in the patient with the polymyositis and the dermatomyositis, but anti-JO1 antibodies is the most common one. Of course, the latest theory is the type 1 interferon response that might be responsible for the perifacial atrophy in the dermatomyositis. Here we can see that there is some of the lichenate tissue reaction with this, some of the vascular changes in the basal layer with the some of the seabed bodies. The morphology, of course, I have said that there will be the perifacial atrophy of the muscle, and there will be the segmental fiber necrosis and the regeneration. We can see here some of the perifacial atrophy here. These are my references. Thank you.